triple B's. The NCAA has made some concessions in the past year, including just allowing athletes to sign endorsement deals. And at this point, their hands are kind of tied. They kind of have to do that, especially with top-tier players like Jalen Green forgoing college altogether to make six figures at the G League level. The NCAA had to act and make playing at the college level economically appetizing, and they did so with a few rule changes. Now, this has been a long time coming, and there are definitely people to credit for this, but Lavar Ball is definitely one of those people. I feel like I should give Lavar Ball some credit, because probably the only person giving him credit for this is Lavar Ball. Now, when Lavar Ball waged a one-man war with the NCAA, everyone thought he was crazy. This was a battle he probably wouldn't win. You know, in my head at the time, I kind of equated it to Jan Hus going up against the church in the 1400s. Things didn't go too well for Jan as he was eventually burned at the stake, but things went a little bit better for Lavar. And before I get further into this, no, this is not a Lavar Ball PR piece. I mean, what do you think, I wear slightly soiled $500 Triple B underwear and have a Lavar shrine in my room? I don't do that anymore. Lavar is a flawed man, a deeply flawed man at times. But I'm just trying to give credit where credit is due and highlight the impact he's made. The first case where he done changed the game. The first is through the guidance of his son LaMelo's career. Lavar made several drastic, unprecedented moves that most considered heinous when it comes to LaMelo's future. The first being pulling LaMelo out of school to play in Lithuania to become a professional player. Now, LaMelo didn't thrive in Lithuania, where the sun only shines once in a decade, but it did give him valuable experience as a professional. And at least he got paid, or at least should have gotten paid, as he had a signature shoe out at the time. When that shoe dropped, Lavar said this: "He's going to have a shoe. NCAA ain't gonna tell me shit, because they're not my boss." Get wrecked. Now, Triple B finances are a completely different story, and at times can get pretty Enron-y, but the point is, LaMelo was following a path not previously traveled. When he came back to the US and there were questions about his NCAA eligibility, nobody in the Ball family seemed too fazed. Lavar did say that the NCAA was using LaMelo to make a point, but ultimately it didn't seem like anyone was in doubt about LaMelo's future. From the outside looking in, it definitely seemed like they were confident about LaMelo's journey of getting to the NBA smoothly without playing 1 minute of collegiate basketball. And it 100% worked, as within the last year, LaMelo went from a fringe first round pick to now a consensus top 5 overall pick, as he thrived at the Illawarra Hawks in Australia and now owns the fucking team. And I know the NCAA likes to pump up that student athlete bullshit, especially with their one and done players who major in Swahili. But LaMelo actually got a real-world education in Australia. Can you get more business savvy than actually owning a professional team? Score one, big baller brand, and score zero for the NCAA. The bottom line is that LaMelo followed an unorthodox plan and renewed confidence that you could be a high draft pick without the NCAA entirely. And I don't want to blame the complete lack of confidence in drafting a player that just came back from overseas on Emmanuel Mudiay, but And RJ Hampton, who was another top prospect that played overseas who deserves attention and credit, but ultimately I give most of it to LaMelo, as the media was kind of crazy and chaotic around him, and most of it at the time was this Australia venture is just going to be a disaster, and that changed to, oh, he's a top 5 pick, pretty much the moment he took the court in Australia. And step 2 of this process, the most groundbreaking step, a step never before seen in a while. That is, of course, the founding of the JBA, the Junior Basketball Association. Founded by Lavar Ball, directed by Lavar Ball and Alan Foster, and sponsored by Big Baller Brand. The JBA's purpose was essentially to serve as an alternative to the NCAA for high school and junior college players. It was announced that top players would be making around $10,000 a month. There are 8 teams total with 10 players on each team, and the hope that it would attract top high school players who are planning on going the one-and-done route in college instead. Lavar's press release kind of reminded me of what Suge Knight said about Bad Boy and Puff Daddy at the 1995 Source Awards. The press release went as followed, at least parts of it. "There is no need to partake in an institution that claims its purpose is to not help you prepare for your professional career." The recent statement from the president of the NCAA, Mark Emmert, when commenting on the recent withdrawal of LiAngelo Ball from UCLA, sums it up. He went on to quote the president, who had this to say: "Is this a part of someone being a part of your university as a student athlete, or is it about using college athletics to prepare yourself to be a pro? If it's the latter, you shouldn't be there in the first place." Sorry, the fart wasn't included. Lavar went on to say, "For decades, the NCAA has run a business that has exploited thousands of teens, while college institutions, coaches, media conglomerates, and corporate sponsors have all profited from the model." Phew, end of statement. Sorry, I don't have the highest reading level. This certainly drew a line in the sand like Suge did in 95. Now, I'm not going to pretend that the JBA was a financial success, because it wasn't. I don't have the financial records, and I'm certainly not like that douche Jim Cramer with his bells and whistles, but it just doesn't pass a basic eye test. All the top high school recruits the JBA contacted, including current Heat player Tyler Hero, rejected them. Reportedly, 80 out of 80 top recruits turned them down, and LaMelo and LiAngelo were really the only draws for the league, and LaMelo was the only top 150 prospect to actually play in the JBA. Second, LaVar charged ridiculously high prices as only big ballers do, and there wasn't a good turnout. No game came really even close to selling out the 10,000 seat capacity that the JBA venues offered. And to make matters worse, at the end of the first season, players were coming out to say that they weren't paid what they were promised, and many regretting their decision to turn pro in the first place just for a brief stint in the JBA. All the negative press coming out kinda made LaVar look like a snake oil salesman, or for the people in the younger generation that don't exactly get that reference, imagine a woman in her 30s trying to recruit you on Instagram to join her essential oils business. After LaMelo moved on to prep school and Jello hurt his ankle, the league was pretty much assumed dead. People thought LaVar gave up on it. And it hasn't played since and probably never will, so those assumptions are correct. But something very important happened just months after the first JBA season. The G League, the minor league affiliate from the NBA, well, they made an announcement of a professional path for players who aren't NBA eligible yet, with the opportunity to make up to $125,000 and to have complete control of their name and likeness. Does it sound similar? Now, the G League deal is 1,000 times better offer than that of what the JBA could offer, but this goes to show, in the case of the JBA, it doesn't pay to be first. I know we've all seen D'Angelo talk with Wallace about Chicken McNuggets on the wire. Of course, it definitely didn't help that they also screwed over a bunch of people. Regardless, people prophesized that this was the death of the JBA and gave themselves a pat on the back while doing so, even though every single sign was there. The G League announcement ended on a high level, the pathway to being a one-and-done and going only through either the college route or going overseas to play. And it probably wouldn't have gotten there without a swift shove from the JBA, although they executed everything horribly. Top prospects from the NBA are slowly starting to flock to the G League, and the NCAA really has no other choice but to make some accommodations for the athletes, like allowing them to profit off their name, likeliness, and image. And although he didn't profit from it and made a wrong financial decision every step of the way, Lavar Ball is definitely one of the people you have to thank when the new NCAA football and basketball games come out again. And don't get me wrong, the NCAA will still make a shitload of money, as it's impossible to replicate the NCAA rivalries and traditions in the G League level. And there really isn't an alternative for NCAA football, but this has definitely shifted the landscape forever. And you know, somewhere LaVar is smiling a big triple B smile, knowing that he had a part in taking some money, however much money that may be, out of the NCAA's pocket. And right now the NCAA is scrambling, they're getting nervous, and you never know. They may just need a clean pair of triple B underwear for those shitty britches. Alright folks, that is it. Thank you, like, comment, and subscribe. It's corny, but it really does help the channel. One video a week. Check out the Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, as well as our website, votetheprocess.com. I just released an in-depth statistical article on whether or not there's a relationship between Joel Embiid's performance on the road and that city's Chick-fil-A ratings. So check it out. That is groundbreaking research and journalism. Link in the description. Paradise, play us off. Meditate is what I find therapeutic. And we smoking all night, going stupid. What we gonna do?